Good morning, everyone. I'm gonna try to do this from my studio. Obviously, just go easy on me in terms of the content here. I'm just trying this out, so we'll see how it goes. Okay, so basically, this is Christo and Jean-Claude's work, The Gates. They're really interesting artists. They're a duo. They are known for doing big sort of interventions into landscapes across the world. The Gates is just one example of that. Basically, it's these iron sort of frames with these sort of mylar fabric. They look like kind of like capes that they put all through Central Park. Now, they've wrapped government buildings. They've surrounded an island in Florida. It kind of looks like Pepto-Bismol. You can kind of take a look at those things online if you want. Here's another sort of view of Central Park. We can see that as it goes around, it goes all through Central Park. So it's kind of like this idea of painting the landscape itself with these sort of modern kind of motifs here. Okay? Now, the most important things to take away from Christo and Jean-Claude's work is that their work is really about what we call ephemera, okay? And what ephemera means is that the works are only there for a certain amount of time and then they're gone, okay? They can't be bought, they can't be sort of profited off of in any sort of way. They're sort of for the people, and it goes down to like a, It goes down to sort of a philosophical idea, right? Of that their work sort of represents sort of champions the idea of kind of the idea of socialism in a particular way, because what else that he does is that he draws all of these sort of giant installations, interventions in his studio. And what Jean-Claude does is that he sells these drawings of the perspective installation or big artwork. He sells those for millions of dollars, but instead of like using the money, to buy himself Ferraris and things like that, he dumps the money back into getting materials, to fund these kinds of giant installations. This one costs $60 million. So he generates $60 million worth of money, of revenue, selling his paintings, his drawings of what's going to be made, and then he makes it. So it's a really interesting sort of philosophical idea of that these are impermanent, these are like not meant to be owned, these are for like the people, and they're purely sort of aesthetic. They're art for art's sake. They're meant to be beautiful, and they're meant to be appreciated in that way. So that's kind of the meaning, is they're just supposed to kind of make us feel like, oh my God, this is incredible, or that this can't happen. This is surreal, right? So that's Christo and Jean-Claude. They're one thing to mention is that they are a wife and husband sort of art duo, okay? She kind of handles all of the financing and everything like that, and he does the art, but they kind of moonlight together as one sort of art collective. All right. So that should do it for The Gates. I've also linked videos. I'm gonna send you an email that links some videos, great videos about each artist, so that you can watch it and so you can get a better understanding. Okay, so let's move along to Basquiat, and we have here Basquiat's Horn Players. Basquiat is a painter. He exploded in the 80s. He was living as a vagrant in New York City in sort of a cardboard box. He started to draw, and he ends up handing a bunch of drawings to Andy Warhol, which is another famous artist, and his kind of career sort of blew up at that point. He was basically and mainly a graffiti artist that did a lot of street graffiti in New York. And then the art world kind of, he got bankrolled by a gallery. The gallery bought him paints, gave him a place to live, and he ends up starting to paint. Now, he's very interesting kind of character. He's completely self-taught. No, he didn't ever go to art school. He never did anything like that. He's one of my favorite artists. He's one that inspired me in the beginning of my art career, because he's so unique in terms of he's just like this enigma that pops out of nowhere in the 80s and kind of really impacted the contemporary modern art scene at the time. And one of the reasons he impacted it so hard was because he was so free. He's kind of known as the Black Picasso. He really thrives in this sort of chaos and control, right? And I think this is really represented here in the horn players because it's sort of a visualization of music, okay? So we have all of these different things. We have the canvas fractured into different sections. This is acrylic on canvas, I believe. Yes. And paint stick, which is just oil paint in sort of a stick form, like a giant pastel. And so he was very, like, wild, right? And his art seems to encapsulate that wildness. See how he writes things and then scratches them out, paints things and paints them out. But at the same time, there's an overall sort of compositional cohesiveness to the work. It's very tight, right? Like, it is very... everything that he does seems to have like this purpose, right? Like this kind of intention that's very, very, very unique. Because I've heard him referred to as a radiant child, as a smart child, because his work is very childlike. But it's very intelligent also. And so it's really important to understand those kinds of things about Basquiat, that he is this very sort of tour de force that impacts the art world at a time when there weren't a lot of artists or there was no one sort of like him. So he comes in off the street and he does these kind of just brilliant, very messy, very childlike, giant paintings. And... you know, kind of, for me, he kind of reintroduced freedom back into painting and into the art world. And, you know, that nothing really has to really have a reason. And he's using a lot of different vocabularies in these paintings, right? And this is sort of the birth of what we call postmodernism, where we've talked about that in class, how far can painting go? Well, Basquiat says, well, you know, I'll write on it, I'll do this, I'll do that, I'll move things around, I'll use collage. you know, it's just his work is very liberating. And I think the horn players really encapsulates that liberation of painting. So that's the horn players. Okay, so we're gonna look at this piece. This is Androgyny number 3. It's by Magdalena. I can't say her last name. I never have been able to. So we're just gonna leave it at that. So this is 1985. This is burlap, resin, wood, nails, and string. Okay, so let's walk through the piece. Sort of formally for a second here. So the piece is, it's a sculpture. It's made out of wood. And then we have burlap, which is sort of a fabric that's sort of soaked in resin to make it hard to make this sort of cast-like shape. You can see the inside of the cast is here. And then on the exterior, we can see this. Now, we have a seated human figure, and he's sort of up on this sort of plank, right? Her work is really influenced by trauma, okay? She saw her own mother having her arm blown off by the Nazis. She was a sort of member of a very affluent family in Germany, in Warsaw, Germany, and when the Nazis kind of came to power, her family was sort of stripped of their titles. Like I said, she witnessed her own mother having her arm blown off by a Nazi soldier. And she witnessed all of the atrocities of the Nazis and of war. So her work really, really reflects those things. It's really about the body. This piece in particular, you can see that the legs have been amputated. Either the arms have been amputated. It's a piece of sorrow. And it's also it's very powerful. The bottom of the, as you can see, the stretching of the wooden beams right here are sort of bandaged at the end. This kind of references the sort of stumps or the amputation of limbs. To me, I've always felt like this really represented also like the Nazi concentration camps of the people just being sort of dissolved, if you will, of their humanity and of their sort of form. So she sort of attacks the form, right? And sort of gets it into this state where you see this sort of dissolving of the human figure. Oops. I want to sort of recap the lecture really quickly here with, you know, showing some other examples of the work. So here is the gates here. And then here is another example of Christo and Jean-Claude's wrapping an island in Florida. You can see in this Pepto-Bismol pink. I really wanted to show you guys this piece.
Okay. Number two.
By this artist.
Not functional.
So here, as we can see, this is another piece from the Androgyny series, and I think that these are way different for me. They're very much more sexual, right? Like, we have a lot of sexual looking sort of things of like we can see here, it's very, really interesting sexually, right? We have the red color. But again, they're all resin and they reference the body and they really reference trauma a lot in the work. And we can see here another image of this. It also has this idea of this person sort of being lifted up on this sort of pedestal of pain, right? Her work is very emotive of pain and of sorrow and of personal struggle. And then we have the horn players here, and then we have a little picture here of Basquiat and and his being compared to Picasso. Right here, there's a really close comparison. And I think that's made, I'm not sure. I mean, I think that he was as good a painter and an inventor and composer as Picasso, but I think their projects are very different. I think that he is more about just pure expression, right? And Picasso was sort of, his project was more about sort of the deconstruction or the abstraction of the form. So, we'll end that for today. Let me flip the camera around here, or not, I don't know. Okay, so here's a little video tour of my studio. I had my camera in a shoe. I'm not very good at this. Here's some of my work. You can see my studio is like completely full of paintings right now. Some that you've seen, some that you guys haven't seen. I thought you might enjoy this little video tour here of the studio and the space that I'm in. So I hope you guys are doing okay. I hope everything is going well. I'll try to post more videos ASAP. All right, bye.